I don't know the answer to my own questions. I don't know what I want, so I want nothing.
I don't know the answer to my own questions. I don't know what I want, so I want nothing.
I don't know the answer to my own questions. I don't know what I want, so I want nothing.
I don't know what I want, to my own so questions. I want nothing. I don't know what I want, so I want nothing.
Hit schedule, bloody lecture, first thing on Monday morning. I swear Janine's got it in for me.
Well, at least you get it over and done with.
Oh, is that supposed to help?
Well, yeah. How do you feel you had a lecture last thing?
Which module?
The Victorian Asylum.
But I'm not ready. I'm only doing this because John's gone off.
You make him sound like a bottle of milk.
Well, skin tone.
What?
Milky.
Mm. Yeah, he does have very white skin, but better complexion than either of us.
Well, you know what his secret is, don't you?
Never goes out in daylight.
That's why the students called him Dracula. You nervous?
Oh, you know, first year's first thing. I'm just trying to get on top of the moment when it all began to change.
We went from bedlam to bed, the golden age of asylums.
You'll be fine.
I hope so.
Right, I am off.
Yes, it's like you're wrestling with a giant hydra mental health. You cut off one head and then there's 10 more.
They'll all be asleep anyway.
Who? The students!
Yeah. Cheers, thanks for that.
Norfolk County Asylum. That's October 1861. Queen Victoria is on the throne. Agricultural labourers work a 10.5-hour day for 8 shillings a week, and 6-year-olds pick stones from the fields. The age of consent is codified in law at 12. A very wet month followed a very wet summer. And that is in this month that Dr. William Charles Hills arrived at the door of the Norfolk County Asylum.
Mr. Gerlin, I was just saying to Mary Ager how lucky she is to have come with Dr. Hills in charge. It used to be you could smell the drains before you even walked through the gatehouse, and oh, as for the wards, they were that overcrowded you could barely move. Oh, and the last medical superintendent. Poor old devil did away with himself. You might say the asylum did him in.
Yes, Dr. Hills was everything the visiting committee was looking for. A man known to console those who were afflicted.
And there certainly was a lot of affliction in our asylum.
I was at his very first committee meeting. The reverends, there were 4 of them, didn't know what hit them. He took a seat before them and made a statement which was pleasing and showed the committee exactly how he intended to operate.
He told them that he would perform his duties to the satisfaction of the committee and that no exertion shall be wanting in his part to promote the health and comfort of the patients.
Comfort and health for the patients, first, second and third.
He wanted to bring their attention to the crowded state of the asylum. Currently, he was compelled to make up beds on the floor.
Demand number 2 was put.
Waste and sewage flowed into the river.
And what was the point of that?
Whereas in a closed cesspool, that could be used to fertilise the farmland. That meant we wouldn't have to buy manure. And our crops, with our own waste, spread on our own soil, well, that'd be the best in Norfolk.
He was full of new ideas. He even found a girl to play piano in the chapel on a Sunday morning. We were missing the joy of a bit of music. Detail. He was a details man. A very private details man.
We nestle like the country estate. We have dances, entertainments, and trips to the seaside. When you're a bit better, dear.
I have never had so much pleasure or felt so much pain as I have in these 20 hectares. Although I don't know how he bears it, Dr. Hills. There is such a tide that washes up at his door. And sometimes there are things that even he can't control.
Help! Help, come quick!
That's a tide that washes in from the bleached countryside. The beggar alleys and the hollowed out homes. A tide so strong that sweeps through the centuries and that never stops.
Why wasn't someone watching him?
Well, who knew? Who could possibly have known?
How are we going to tell Dr. Hills?
Dr. Hills, watching the tide.
can. My name is Miss Field, and I'm going to be taking you through this module on the 19th century asylum. So, what's an asylum? You all look a bit blank. Early, isn't it?
As home.
I'm sorry, did someone say something?
To find my Tom of Bedlam, 10,000 years I travel. Mad maudlin goes on dirty toe to save me shoes from gravel.
Has someone got music on? Could you please all turn off your mobile phones? Thank you. Insanity has always been with us.
Dr. Hills trusted me to copy by hand for him. I had a good hand, but I found that I was disturbed by some of the words he used. Take lunacy. What there is contained in this one word. Lunacy. Lunatic. Wild foolishness. Extravagant folly. Governed by the phases of the moon. Dr. Hills leaves the moon out of it, as a man of science would.
The noun insanity originates from the Latin insanitatum, meaning unhealthfulness, a severe disorder of the mind.
If you are insane, you are presumed incurable. But not Dr. Hills. He believed we could be cured. He points to its cause, debility.
So, mental health is emotional and spiritual resilience. A state of well-being in which every individual can reach his or her own potential and can cope with the normal stresses of life. Yeah, you at the back? What's normal? Indeed. Many of the words used in the past can sound unusual or can make us uneasy or confused, but they will relate to the conditions you'll meet today.
Melancholia. One day able to rise with the dawn and the next barely able to move. Now there is a word I have eaten.
Take melancholia. The word's not in our lexicon today. Today we use depression, but in the past it was used to describe both this and a variety of associated conditions. Melancholia could include...
acidia. The indifference of a soul which has lost the love of God. Tedium or perturbation of the heart. Sinful.
Nowadays, GP surgeries use forms as the first step in reaching any kind of prognosis. Simple.
Simple or stupid?
The old terms can be very off-putting.
Stupid, slow of mind.
They can seem cruel. Take moral insanity. The intellect remains, but the moral feelings of the mind are unsound. It's an entirely 19th century construct. What it really means is...
excess. Moral perversions, sexual excitements, hysteria.
A lack of self-control.
Monomania.
Schizophrenia, paranoia.
Talking to supernatural beings.
Many of you will end up working in a hospital context. In the past, huge buildings were constructed with walls. Men to one side, women to the other. They were, in some ways, a mirror to the workhouse. But with duty of care. These were known as county asylums.
Asylum. Now there is a word with a whole world in it.
In the past, if you were poor and mentally sick, the only place you could go was the workhouse or the county asylum.
There is a whole universe behind that word.
Of course, things were very different in the past. Huge wards, hundreds of beds. Very few staff, hardly what you call trained. Unlike today.
Asylum. Some have looked at the walls of this palace and our gatehouse, our corn bricks and our grey roof slates and I'll call it a prison.
Asylums were places where people stayed for years, sometimes their whole lives. It's not a term we use now.
And inside the walls, we, the patients, are locked away.
Asylum.
But if you are surrounded by darkness, if the darkness has climbed inside of you and you cannot shake it out,
You cannot tear it out. You cannot spit or vomit the blackness of her out. Rather, call it a resting place. On your broken knees at the door, pleading for help. When the mania has got you and the devil is holding you over the flames.
Asylum.
Give me.
Asylum.
Help me.
Asylum.
It's lost its meaning.
It meant everything.
I watch others arrive as I once arrived. I watch the expressions on their faces when they first see their new home. To some, that is a marvel. Beds with sheets, a holy revelation. Flower beds scented with roses. The airing courts, the dormitory wings. Of course, some are too far gone to notice. Some can barely lift their heads and countless stones on the roof. I watch them arrive and join the dance. Our lunatics ball. Charlotte Wilson. I remember the day she was brought here. The relieving officer gave her into the care of the matron. 18th of June. 1881, a beautiful summer's day. She was rambling, incoherent, mad.
Come, Miss Wilson.
Come. Tell the voice of the rats. It's their turn now to bake the bread and sweep the floor. I've seen the shadows in the night gathering now to dance on their own. Each one calling on the Lord to come out and play in the sun. Oh, it's the bottom of the day when the washing is dirty in the fields. So a buzzard wants to eat a mouse. Don't touch me, don't!
Lively blasphemous one this. Stinks and all.
That's quite enough of that, sir.
What, I only said she stinks.
Do you stop here? She won't have anything said to the patients to make them feel uncomfortable. Shake his
you know that.
I'm tight on, she's not listening.
No, but I am.
Admission! The booking in. The bar. And I wonder, and Dr. Hills wondered, what brought her to our receiving room? She was a domestic servant, a woman a fortnight from her own wedding. Where did her suffering begin?
Charlotte, it's been more than a year since your mother died. She would not want you to.
What, Father?
It's constant grieving, it's not.
What, Father?
It's not natural.
Why? See here my hands, my fingers, my bone. See here the pain of the lost ring on my finger. I stood on the stone and they said to me, yeah, Charlotte, you will be wed. I stood on the stone and they said to me, yeah, Charlotte, you will be wed, but when you are dead, dead, dead. And all the tongues were talking. Did you hear them in the corners of the room? They were like eyes and talk to me and never stop. Listen to them. Talking all the time like there is no silence in them at all. All I want is the silence of my hands. I cannot sleep on my hand. I lay my head down on the ground and the horses trample on my head and it's fine for the horses to come. I want the horses to come, poor my hand. My dress so white, so white, and I can feel the lace. I washed the lace in milk, I boiled the lace in milk, I cooked the lace and ate the lace and spread it before the horses, and the horses ate the lace. I washed the lace, I boiled the lace, I spread it on the bed, I poured it on the bed, and the mistress beat me to cook. Beat me on my head, on my hands. Pain. Close your eyes, Charlotte, close your eyes, Charlotte, close your eyes, Charlotte, close your eyes, Charlotte. My ma, she whispers to me, what does she whisper? I can't remember. I can't remember a devil, you Quim. Go to places, let the devil suck you. Don't touch me, do not touch me. You burn me with your hands. I can see in the dark, I can see in the dark.
Close your eyes, Charlotte, close your eyes, Charlotte, close your eyes, Charlotte, close your eyes,
Charlotte. Make the bread, Charlotte, empty the well, Charlotte. Yeah, I know what the mistress said. The cat and the wild men, all the kittens have gone. There was music in the silence. Did you hear the music in the silence? No, he was there. With his hands. And I told him I have white hands. I told him I have white hands. And I showed him I have white hands. And then he put the ring in the dust. My mom. Close your eyes, Charlotte. Close your eyes, Charlotte. Close your eyes, Charlotte.
In 7 days, Charlotte is quieter. In a month, she has sunk into a torpor, answers few questions, and is one of many amongst. Her manner still strange, but she is eating and sleeping. A few months more and she's at work in the kitchen. She talks sensibly, conducts herself rationally, and is bright and animated. She leaves the asylum a year and a month later, 2 stone heavier, recovered. I ask myself how Dr. Hills was different. Is it because we felt he would never leave us? Is it because in a world where the pauper lunatic, the demented and the epileptics were lower than the mud in the bottom of the ditch, and yet he saw something in us, we would all hear him exacting, like demanding a high standard from his staff. I mean, none of this clipping a man round the head because he is bewildered or washing women down with cold water. No, no, he would have us checked for bruises and any such recorded. He is still pacing in his study. He has had the news, and I am sorry for it. At this time, he would normally walk the wards and talk with the young medical men who come to learn this new kind of alienism. Fresh air. Good food, sleep, and industry. We are no longer presumed incurable. His casebooks are a map of our days. Our voices? Well, you can hear us calling in the night and rambling through the days. We tell the stories of this place. Because we are stories.
Dr. Hills doesn't want to be disturbed.
It's been hours.
What do you expect?
Has he the mill cook sent him?
Untouched.
A heavy blow.
Oh, he takes it personally. I fear.
What?
I can hardly bear to put it into words. He's just sick. One moment he's staring at the fire, the next he opens the casebooks and reads them closely. And then he stops and looks up in the air as if he could hear someone speaking to him.
Oh, good Lord.
No, 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 he's not becoming one with his patients.
Oh, mercy.
But it is as if he is searching for answers in the casebooks.
I see.
He blames himself.
Well, how could he possibly have known?
Oh, none of us are strangers to Lars, and you know yourself that you
no,
question.
Dear Mr. Gerlin, it is God's will.
Is that little enough of God? No, it is as if he's questioning everything he has done here. Girl, he says to me, there have been so few recovered. Well, not a bit of it, sir, I says back to him. I can think of many as has benefited from being here and have gone home recovered. Yes, indeed, there are some, he says, and many who return relapse. That's what he said. And then he turned back to the casebooks.
Well, what did he say to that?
He said, I feel sorrow for what's past, and he
What?
He said, You have been a faithful, efficient servant of the asylum.
Well, that is true, Mr.
No, no, that's not. What I mean is, it's the kind of thing one says when one is...
Speak plainly, Mr. Garland.
When one is going away.
No. The asylum is his life.
Maybe. Maybe it was.
Been a terrible year for him.
And it has.
And now this.
Now this.
And now this.
Teaching bit, I mean the nursing. The money.
I'm being serious.
Oh, I don't know. The luxurious working conditions. The interesting conversations I have every day with someone who's got 10 words to say and keeps repeating them. The uniform, that's a real catwalk draw. Oh, the delight I get from receiving yet another email from management that shows they are so in touch with our reality.
I went into this job because of my aunt.
Yeah, you said.
I witnessed what happened to her. It was like something had just flipped on and off, and then it was there all the time. Exhausting.
Was there a history of mental health in your family?
I don't think so, no, but I reckon I know what did it. She was a single mum, lost a job, couldn't pay rent. She was a dancer. We lost her. Thank God, if it could happen to her, it could happen to anyone.
Come on. Coffee's wasted on you. I'm going to buy you a soup tureen full of hot chocolate with a volcanic eruption of marshmallows and cream. Sound tempting?
No.
G&T? If it's not too early. Yes, that could be more like it.
My parents gave me two names. William. Resolute protector, and Bez, of Hebrew origin, which means sorrowful. Well, I can think of many other names to give me. For this one, well, this one has been my crown of thorns. The first time I saw Dr. Hills, I was gripped by religious fervour, on my knees at my bed, praying. I thought that if I stopped thinking of God for one moment, that he would smite me down. I was wicked. My breath was poison. I had no intestines, just a void. And Dr. Hill stopped, and he smiled at me and waited for me to finish. I told him that I was cursed. He said he didn't believe such a thing. He saw before him a good man. This man, with the overseeing of the asylum estate, the overseeing of all the staff and the overseeing of all the patients, had the time to stop and console me when all I had in my heart was despair. Every time he passed on his rounds, he always had a word with me. In time, we become warm companions. Oh, we talk about everything. Reform. Religion, our place in this world, our place in the next. He believed in moral treatment for the whole person. 1875, and Joseph Henry Scott is on his knees, although his knees have grown to the source, and he is not so numb that he cannot feel the pain. He is a supplicant to our Redeemer. There was a lot of religious mania about.
But God is making... who will not suffer you be tempted above that you
are. Corinthians 10:13, for I know where this man sits in his soul.
But without faith, it's impossible.
Hebrews 11:6. For I believe that this man was born into a house of grief. His parents buried Joseph Henry Scott and then christened their new son by the same name of the baby boy they had lost. Joseph Henry Scott, born 2 years later and placed in the same cot.
And she called his name Joseph.
How did that boy grow?
Another child.
In a house of a shadow of loss. Did he hear his mother instead call for his brother? Did he see in his father's paternal eye the features of lost others? Did he wonder what the first Joseph would have done in his place? Would he have been taller, counted more friends, run more swiftly? All those years, wondering, seeking and pleading, never able to live up to the first Joseph who had no faults.
Joseph's master took him, put him into the prison.
For I have felt like you, and I have spoken the Bible, verse by verse, like you.
That the Lord was with Joseph, shewed him mercy, and gave him favour in the sight of the keeper of the prison.
So he listened, and the music soothed his disappointment, and he vowed that wherever he could, he would bring music into the lives of others. He asked me if I played. I shook my head. Then sing, he said. Everyone can sing.
Oh, lovely Mary, darling, my joy, my only best. If 50 girls were round you, I'd hardly see the rest. Be what it may, the time of day, the place, be where it will, sweet look so merry, Donnelly. They bloom before me still.
Stop, stop, take a breath. Now, ladies, Louisa Sparrow, your voice is a little too shrill. Mrs. Field, if we might have a middle seat. Come now, let us sing the angels into the hall. Let us show these respected members of society just what our community can do with our musical entertainment. Now, Elizabeth Field, let us sing again from her eyes like panting water.
The ball.
Some years we did all the performing ourselves. The Reverend Edward Ram was the enthusiastic director of our farm. Here, we can take music purely for our own pleasure. Can you imagine? A wife of a labourer with 11 children, flayed with exhaustion, being able to enjoy music purely for her own pleasure. Dr. Hills was a radical.
That has me in its power.
Little Louisa Sparrow, 27, but always a look of a child about her.
Now, Louisa Sparrow, you're a flighty thing who should know better.
She's making up for a lost childhood, Reverend, aren't you, dear?
Take a break, ladies, while I think through our little scene. But I would ask you if you all sing like lovely Mary Donnelly is not, well, not.
She came on the 16th of March, 1875. I remember seeing her arrive, so I walked from my place of prayer under the sky. And I prayed to the Lord God that here was another broken child for this place to repair. And looking at her eyes, glittering with a fever of thought, just for a moment, I questioned my God and wondered why we must suffer this. Day after day.
Do you like my ribbons, Louisa? I've been making things to sell at the bazaar and Matron lets me use the scraps. Finery for our ball, didn't you think? Oh, you could put ribbons in your hair and all.
Sometimes I just need to rest my head. I didn't know where I am or what my thoughts are doing.
Better like that for me too. I have no control over my thoughts.
Sometimes I feel like there's a load of moths inside my head battering themselves against my skull to get out. I feel better when I can't remember. Do you ever think about the future?
Here, there's only the present.
I can't think about it. Not the past nor the future. I know it's a sin what I've done, but it makes my head hurt to think of it.
Gosh, I don't believe there's one amongst us who has sinned.
You had a baby.
Mom.
I never did tell him what happened.
Who?
My parents. They wanted to know who the father was. But I never said. They wanted to know where it happened, if it was just one time. One time, although a mortal sin meant maybe my soul could be saved. It was many times. In the back of the hawthorn fields where the lambs were put, he told me I was a sweet little thing and that I tickled his fancy. He made a promise to me. My mother couldn't look at me for a month. She knew, though I never breathed a word. She kept crying and praying. My father would have taken the strap to me to get the name. He said he would make him pay for my ruin, but my mother begged him not to. My head hurt all the time. I didn't want to go on out. I was spoiled goods, and no one would ever want to marry me. That's what my mother said. I said, well, that means you got a servant for life. I wished I hadn't, though, because then she clapped me around the head. After that, I didn't want to go anywhere. He said he would come back for me. I looked out the window every day for ages. Even after I had the baby, I looked out the window. Surprised my nose in flat all that time I had it pressed up against the glass. At first, I thought, well, maybe something terrible's happened to him and that's why he doesn't come back to get me. Then I heard tell he was engaged. I never knew your skin could stretch so much. My grandmother came to help my mother with my labour. I was a handful, apparently. I didn't like to think about the birth, but the baby was healthy and a boy, so that cheered him up. Me, I couldn't walk for a week. I did nurse a bit. I had all this milk coming out of me and I had to go somewhere. My mother would bring the baby to me, but it hurt when it fed, and my grandmother made this salve of chamomile, but it still hurt. I kept falling asleep and nearly dropping it. I never knew you could be so tired. He laid me arms out, just holding him. He had very blue eyes. I used to look at his little face crying. How red he would get in those little wrinkles and the little tears that would roll down onto my hands. Then my mother or someone would come and take him away from me. They would look at me like I was wrong. I am wrong. And ashamed. But I like the name we gave him. I say we, but, well, it was my idea. His middle name for the time of year he was born. William Christmas Sparrow. That name makes up for everything.
Her nose is straight and handsome. Her eyebrows lifted up. Her chin is very neat and pert and smooth like a china cow. Her hair's the brag of Ireland, so weighty and so fine, it's rolling down upon her and gathered in a twine.
Elizabeth Field, admitted 8th of March 1879, wife of a demon, 31 years of age, a woman adrift on a blood red tide, and her sister-in-law, her anchor, her compass, died young. 29.
She's in a terrible state. Should she be left in there on her own?
Mr. Little has said to leave her be.
But look at her. She's lying in her own menses.
Well, she's not going to die of it. No woman ever did.
And you're sure we should leave her like that?
I am.
Poor lamb. She's grieving for her baby.
It's not her baby she's lost. It's home with her father. Herself she's lost.
Well, I think I'd be the same if I had to leave my baby.
Well, you wouldn't be here if you had a baby. We don't have young married women working in the asylum. Dr. Hills will see her tomorrow when she's a bit quieter. And she may well recover. Some do.
I hope she does.
Stand back. She's coming to the door. I do not want her to feel watched.
Oh, she needs a ball.
Don't you ever let me hear you make a sound like that again.
I beg your pardon.
No matter the provocation, not in front of the patients, and neither should it occur before the staff. These people are children in our care, and they deserve our compassion and never our disgust.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean... I feel very sorry for her.
You've only just joined us. You will learn our ways.
I told him I'm 18 months pregnant. I carry my baby Alice safe and sound.
Boy?
Husband?
I've been forced by your absence to take a housekeeper. I have enough to do already with the business and the children.
What?
The children. Do you not think of them? Alice needs a woman in her life.
The children? Do I not think of the children?
I am thinking of the children. Miss Copeman is a good woman. She lives with us now and has them in her care. The children have taken to her and Alice.
You've brought another woman into my home to take my children.
No, not at all, Elizabeth, but what am I to do? Miss Copeland is a housekeeper, and until you are feeling better, I need help.
She? You want another and not me? You want this Miss Copeland in our home? How old is she? Where did you find her?
No, Elizabeth, you're not yourself.
Oh, not Alice. She should never have Alice, because Alice is safe inside me. She would never have Alice ever. You will never have Alice.
Elizabeth!
Get off me, go!
Elizabeth conforms to the routine of the asylum. She talks sensibly. She is quite harmless. After 3 years, she's allowed to go home. Her husband waits for her at the gatehouse. And in his arms, he carries a 3-year-old child.
Alice!
Liz?
Is that you? Oh, how good to see you.
I knew it's so good to see
you. Oh, you look well. God,
I'm absolutely knackered. Makeup's on the trick then.
But what are you doing here? I heard you got promoted. Congrats, although, you know, not surprised. You're easily the best student in the year.
No, what about Andrea?
Yeah, Andrea doesn't have your charm.
Ah, God. I feel like I'm here under false pretences.
Hi. You're always welcome back.
Well, Jane's asked me to come in and talk to the new students about working on a clothes board.
Yeah, you'll be great at that. Very nice lot, too.
But if
what
I...
What is it?
I'm leaving.
The hospital?
Yeah, and Anne? I'm getting out of mental health. So you see why I feel a bit of a hypocrite. I would have made something up, you know, not come, but I didn't want to let Jane down.
Something happened.
It's not just one thing.
Look, I know this is old fashioned. I really thought if there's a calling, then this girl's got it.
Please,
well, what happened?
You inspired me, you know. You made me feel like I can make a difference. You know, when you first go into it, you're naive and you think you're going to help, but... Well, no one tells you that sometimes you just make it worse for them. We discharge them out into the community and they are worse than when they came in. I didn't come into mental health to do that.
I know, it is a difficult balance, and yet sometimes you can't help everyone.
It's like saying they're incurable.
Funny that, presumed incurable, just be looking into
what's
that.
What's my point?
But,
there's not enough therapy. Access is ridiculously hard. There's not enough time, there's definitely not enough money. And there's so many coming in, you've got no idea. 16 to 18 year olds, people 60 plus who have stopped working.
It can be very
And I won't even go into what it's like dealing with people's attitudes on the outside. There's this local supermarket where I work, and they don't like us coming in. They don't talk to us. If they treat us, the staff, like lepers, God knows how they treat the patients.
I see how difficult it is. I do.
What do I tell these first years? That most new nursing staff last a year on an acute ward? That on a forensic ward it's 2 months?
I don't know.
Neither do I.
Alone. Always alone. Not everyone goes home. 1875. I don't think I've ever met a more obstinate patient than Hannah Harper. But then why would she want to comply? Outside these walls, she had but one path to tread. From childhood, she sought to be alone, resembling a Trappist nun rather than a member of a noisy, loving family of seven. But maybe this silent child had dreams that none of us could understand. And then her world broke.
Anne, your father cannot work today.
We heard him coughing all night.
Run up to the farmhouse and tell John Barrow that he cannot work on account of the phthisis. Mind you, make sure he knows that he will be in tomorrow, God willing. We cannot lose more days of pay. He needs a day's rest for the fever to pass, is all.
Oh, Mother.
Here, child, it's cold enough to freeze your footsteps out there, and in here it's not much better. Draw your shawl about you.
You look so tired.
None of us sleeping with your father coughing all night, except your sister Hannah. Where is she?
She's asleep as if her ears are stopped with cotton.
or pretends to.
Oh, she's so attached to your father, she don't want to hear him suffering.
Or she doesn't want to help.
Hannah? Hannah! Where are you, girl? Hannah? Where have you been? Did you not hear me calling? Fetch kindling for the fire and then water. How can I hope to keep your father alive in such a cold house? There he is, coughing his soul out. Hurry, child.
My father slipped away with the White Death just 3 days later. Our poor mother was the strength of us all as we gathered to work out how we'd keep from the workhouse. All but Hannah, who vanished for ours. She was silent when she returned. My mother pleaded with the vicar to find a position in a big house for Hannah, for she was the eldest of us after all and must take on her duty. Reluctantly, my mother parted with Hannah, for we were used to her ways, but others might not be so accepting. Quiet she was always, sullen but a watcher. She saw everything, I knew that. I knew too that her heart was like a trapped bird in her chest. She came home when she could.
Hannah, is that you? Oh, come, my dear daughter. We've missed you so much. The others will be home soon. Anne is in service, but 10 miles from here. Did you walk here? Yeah, of course you did. I can see from the mud on your boots. Well, at least it's a fair day to cross the fields. How is the work, Hannah?
Ma,
I've been to your father's grave. No stone still, but a wealth of primroses. Oh, I often think of him, lying up there on top of the hill, looking out across the fields. He would be so proud of you, Hannah, working in a big house.
I want to come home.
Oh, Hannah.
They make me do all the heavy work.
Well, of course they do. You were young and strong. That is what you were for.
They're spiteful to me.
I am sure that is not so. It's a respectable house. Are you behaving well?
Please.
You cannot just come home.
But I hate it there.
Well, what else is there? Do you want to work in the fields like your father? 10.5 hours a day picking turnips? Up to your knees in mud? Your hands so cold you cannot feel them?
I thought not.
Now. Wages.
I earned this, not you.
Daughter, I should not have to ask.
It's not fair.
No, but that is the way it is for us. There's no point pretending anything different.
It wasn't long then. Up at the big house, they said she'd grown bad-tempered and strange. They sent her back to us like unwanted goods. And her strangeness, well, it weighed on our mother. We were so sorry, but my mother, she couldn't cope. Not with Hannah, she was.
9 years. They never come.
It was a long and difficult journey, but we did come.
Always honour you here, girl. Get dressed, do this, do that. Sometimes all I want to do is stop. Watch the rain trickling down the window.
I couldn't believe how grand it was. The flower beds out front.
I don't know the answer to my own questions. I don't know what I want, so I want nothing.
She was a trouble and was being constantly watched by attendants, so we weren't even allowed to see her.
9 years.
After she died, my brother John visited the asylum. He wanted to thank them all for the care they devoted to Hannah over so many years. He was told that she was not alone in her passing. One of the ward attendants, Sarah Barnard, sat with her at the end. I can't tell you what that meant. We took her home to Shotton, and we buried her in the churchyard next to Farmer. so that she could lie there, watching over those fields she used to walk.
She's got another email!
Right.
They need to get someone in.
They won't do that. That involves spending money.
I am trying to read stats for my next lecture, Women and Depression. I want to see if it's the same ratio then as today. Twice as many women as men.
Can you blame us? What's on offer?
Only then women were locked up too.
Yeah.
Because of depression and poverty.
No,
for not conforming to expectations of behaviour. Have you ever come across a Dr. Isaac Baker Brown? He believed women's mental health issues stem from reading too many books and too much independence of mind. He also practiced clitorectomies on his patients.
You're joking.
No. Although the Lunacy Commission has caught up with him, he was stopped. So different from what was happening in Norfolk at the time. I mean, you don't exactly see Norfolk as trailblazing for mental health, but in the 1850s it really was. Their medical superintendent bought a grand piano for a music-making patient. Another was given an accordion because she liked to play. Can you imagine that happening today?
Women were still locked up.
I know it's not fashionable, but I do think certain events in a woman's life, childbirth, menopause, carries susceptibility.
Depression and poverty cause the most misery in the world, full stop.
The thing is, the more I look back, some of these women, they had a rest from their lives.
You are not suggesting that women were better off in a Victorian asylum.
No, of course not. It's just, come on. It's this millennium we need to worry about.
Caseload is exploding.
I don't know the answer to my own questions.
I don't know the answer to my own questions. I don't know what I want, so I want nothing.
I don't know the answer to my own questions.
So I want nothing.
I don't know what I want, so I want nothing.
What the hell am I doing here?
I've been to see Dr. Hills in his study. He is struggling with a question that breaks his heart to answer. Takes a glass of brandy. Once again, he reads the lists of hymns sung and the testament spoken in the chapel at his boys' school in February this year. A short, dark month for such a good man. I took his arm and prayed in my heart for him then, as I pray in my soul for him now.
I suppose he was a fine son. He was a very handsome boy. I'd see him sometimes in the school holidays. Poor Monson.
How old was he?
16.
What did he die of?
Well, I read him between the lines there. I'm sure I would have noticed the boy was ill, but school matrons, well, I have my doubts. All of a sudden, Monson dies after an illness of 10 days, blood poisoning. And apparently no fault to them, although I've heard tell it wasn't exactly what you call clean. Not like here, spotless corridors, fresh beds.
My brother Alfred died the same day he got bitten by a rat. He was only 13. I do miss him.
Dr. and Mrs. Hills wrote to the school to express their heartfelt thanks at how much the school had done to alleviate their sorrow. They are so forgiven.
He carried on, even after the loss of his son. When his first wife died many years before, he requested a fortnight's leave, but only after he stayed working for a month. When he came back after that fortnight, he never mentioned his loss. And this is the same. He just goes about the day to day.
He wears his grief like a skin.
Some people don't understand what a quiet and private man Dr. Hills is. But this, I've never seen him so withdrawn, so unsettled.
He scares me.
He's firm, is all.
He did look tired.
Over 20 years, dear. He's been walking the same wards for over 20 years. I would be tired too.
Do you think he'll...
Well, if he does, who could deny him?
Why did that man...
Shh, dear. Who are we to judge how another feels?
I was not at fault. There is no fault for those of unsound mind. To find my Tom of Bedlam, 10,000 years I travel. Mad Maudlin goes on dirty toes to save me shoes from gravel.
And here we are, ladies and gentlemen, this fine light and airy room is one of the women's wards.
This all looks very comfortable, sir, but where are the chains?
I don't know why he induces these visits. Ignorant they come, ignorant they leave.
We have no chains here, madam. Kindness and industry is the better here.
No, preposterous, sir. We want to see where you lock them up.
You tell him. What's the point in coming if you can't see the real lunatics?
Have we not left the 1660s? There are none here like Bethlehem's poor old William Dowd, chained by the neck, lying in his own filth, causing the fine folk to faint. Is this what they seek when we offer them the architecture of a new age? I never agreed with Dr. Hills the way he would welcome them in. Indeed, encourage people to inspect what we do here, to look at us as though we are exotic beasts who must perform to their prejudices. Well, he would say that unless people understand our methods, our lives here, how will they learn to treat their unfortunate fellows with kindness and understanding? Well, I asked him if he really believed that our neighbours are Samaritans, transformed by what they see and hear, and be encouraged to have mercy outside our walls, where they will happily see a child starve for want of bread and beat a man for questioning the justice in that. Well, he said that many a patient are brought low because of their lives in society, and we have a community here that judges not. He told me of Dr. John Connolly, one of the founders of this new age of the asylum, who said that we must regard our patients as children. Their cares and joys will become ours, and our whole heart will be given to them. Well, yes, I said, our community judges us not. You judge us not, but out there...
What? They have books to read. Do you mean to say they're literate?
Well, indeed, many are.
But it's nothing like a workhouse.
Where you smother the violent lunatics?
Show us that room.
Let us rise superior to the ignorance and follies of the past.
I beg your pardon.
Let us regard all diseases and their consequences in a like manner, as if making any difference. Bestowing our sympathy with the greatest intensity upon those unhappy beings who, whilst suffering from the pangs of the body, are harassed by very helplessness against the mind.
What? If you ask me, you're feeding them too much. And as for the books and piano, who do you think pays for that? Eh? Well, I'll tell you!
I'm an appeal to your sense of charity, sir.
Say that, but what's the point in spending money on idiots?
This way, please, sir. I will show you where our women patients serve. They are making items that we can sell to raise money for the asylum.
I enjoyed our walks. We would discuss so much. On one, Dr. Hills talked about the circular nature of madness. I asked him what he meant by such a thing. Well, he told me to follow his thoughts and drew a circle in the air. He explained that psychiatric aberrancy is inferred by the antisocial behaviour of a person even while the mental anomaly is advanced to account for that same person's antisocial behaviour. I said, not understanding at all. Then he explained that the illness is the cause of the behaviour for which it is also the excuse. I said again. So, while I was suffering from my illness and I could not cross the threshold of the grocery store for fear of an unforgiving God, a God that I could clearly see was behind the counter, that was my illness that caused me to behave so, but my behaviour that announced my disease also. Exactly, said Dr. Hill. We carried on walking.
That is a fine afternoon in October. The asylum was a ship on a contented sea. We passed the kitchens and the smell of beef tea came upon me. Mr. Long was directing the men out on the farm who were picking the last of the apples from the trees. There was that special Norfolk light. I was tranquil. And for a moment, Dr. Hills himself seemed to harbour a moment of peace. And then his face darkened. There aren't many things to affect his mood, but the sight of Officer Blossom K is one of them. He and any other who he felt should not be sent to the asylum and was falsely pretending illness. This man, who claimed to be the son of a London banker, came to us in 1884 from a magistrate's court in King's Lynn.
You are Henri Bosemkay, a Frenchman by birth?
Indeed, Your Honour, I am.
You don't look very French.
I have acquired the habits and outlook of an Englishman, my lord.
It says here you are a qualified army surgeon.
Indeed, I served with the Red Cross in the Franco-Prussian War.
Did you indeed? Why is this man before me?
He was apprehended in the early hours of a Sunday morning, Your Honour. His clothes were sodden, and he was asking directions to the river to bathe. He explained he'd escaped his father's carriage and wanted to return home clean.
How are you fond of cold baths, fully clothed, Monsieur Bosemkay?
He then said he wanted to take over the Prime Minister's seat in Parliament.
Do you recollect your words?
Not a single one, Your Honour. And as for home, I no longer wish to return home, but would take up my seat of destiny elsewhere.
You shall take your seat, sir, in the county asylum. Next!
And so he come here, not a scrap wrong with him, but spouting concocted delusions. And then, there were a number of letters, refuting his claims to be who he even said he was. Cunning enough to avoid work on the farm, instead, he beds down in the dining room among the women. He might have charmed them, but he did not fool Dr. Hills. I have it from his own mouth that he is, in fact, a man called Wright. Very French. And then, January 1st, 1885.
You must have been very clever to amass such a sum of money.
Mine for when I'm discharged.
Oh, your case comes up before the visiting committee, sir.
Dr. Hill says at the end of the month.
Oh, you know you would benefit from entrusting your money to someone who can keep it safe and see it increase in value. My father is a banker. Lend me your money and I will see it double in value.
I'd like to keep it with me.
Oh, of course you do, as the owner of a... How much is that?
14 shillings.
A fortune! Oh, which could become an even bigger one. I would hardly be able to sleep at night for fear of someone stealing it. You could always let me take it to my father and see it double in a week. I will return it to you before the visiting committee signs you off to leave.
I don't know.
Oh, come now, what have you to lose? You could walk out of here with 28 shillings.
It sounds tempting, but...
But nothing. Lend me your money and I give you my word of honour as a gentleman and the son of a banker that you will profit by it. You will not regret this.
He borrowed some boots too and was found 18 days later wandering around Colchester and taken to the Essex County Asylum. Dr. Hills took great pleasure in discharging him from the asylum books. Thinking on letters, there was one among us, James Winfield, who single-handedly kept the post office in Thorpe St. Andrew in business. Admitted 24th of July, 1877, from Swaffham. He might have been short in stature, but he believed himself to be head and shoulders above the rest of us, including Dr. Hills.
That seems that despite being an illegitimate son, he had been brought up to fancy himself equal to an aristocratic gentleman.
And as you very well know, I got no time for them. But what offends me more is, here is a man who refuses to remove his hat in church.
Thorpe Asylum, February the 9th, 1883. Your Royal Highness.
Oh, thank you very much.
I beg your pardon.
You have addressed me correctly, young man. I am your queen. You may kiss my fingers.
Leave me alone.
What are you doing?
Well, I am writing a letter to royalty.
To me? You're writing a letter to me?
I most certainly am not. I am writing to the Duke of Cambridge.
But
your Royal Highness, in referring to the cartoon with a representation of yourself, though quite the reverse of a likeness, which appeared in the Journal of Fun, January the 17th, I think it only just to myself to address these fun words to you, to inform you that I must be dull of comprehension indeed if I did not at once define their meaning. I do very well remember that a very short time before I was brought to this asylum.
Have you finished it yet?
I entered the George Hotel at Swaffham.
Oh, Swaffham, I've got a sister live there.
Madam, I'm engaged in writing a letter of great import.
Her name is Elizabeth. She's only gone and had 12 children.
And in that bar, there sat a gentleman.
Let me tell you something. There ain't no gentleman in Swaffham.
Madam, if you were a fly, I'd swat you! The only occupier of the place at the time, besides the waitress, Miss Pope.
He never did finish writing that letter, though he wrote countless more. He was discharged, cured of his insanity, on the 27th November 1877. Sadly, nothing could be done for his haughtiness.
Dear Janine, I've enjoyed my time working as a sessional mental health practitioner. Sod that. Dear Janine, saying goodbye to the petty tyrannies of your office will be a pleasure beyond measure. Dear Janine, I can't do this anymore.
Sometimes it's dark in here. No matter the lamps carried by the attendants. No matter the medical superintendent, sometimes you get the darkness in here. Shadows from the past. I have done things. They fly out of the night and make a man sick with the knowledge of what he never knew he was capable of doing. I can see a man and his soul is so tarnished that wrecks a good heart to look on him. That's all there in the tide that comes in. Some days I see Dr. Hills as King Canute, and he has taken his chair and his desk and set them before the waves. And behind him stand the visiting committee in their dog collars and their duty. And inside and outside there is nothing but violence and nothing but poverty. And that's the women and children who suffer. I know of what I speak. James Thompson had everything a man could want. A wife? Child,
them. But did he appreciate what he had? 1877, and he has readmitted, consumed with jealousy.
How much longer do I have to wait for you, Dolly Mark?
It's just ready.
I should have married your sister. But no, 'twas pity moved me. What are you thinking? Look at me! Don't pretend you're not thinking about him. I know what you are.
William, go outside now.
Oh, look at the southern pup. I feed that little runt and I don't even know if he's mine. He should be out earlier, shouldn't he? I could have him scaring crows.
No, James, please. He's still so young.
Young? I was out working when I was his age. Oh, so it's all right for me. I've been working since I was six. But not him. I'll strap the little beast. Don't think I don't know what you get up to when I'm in the fields. Admit it, you foul dad. He ain't mine. You don't even look like me.
I never leave the house.
Liar!
Please.
Shut your mouth.
He is your son.
You say, I don't know what I can see with my own eyes. Are you calling me a liar?
No, husband.
Lying bitch! May you burn in hell. I tell you, I am going to choke the life out of you and that child. Do you think I'm blind? I know what you've been doing. I know what you've done. Come here!
And Henry Grew. Who came in 1875. A congenital idiot. His mother was an imbecile. He had a talent for digging in straight lines. Being told what to do, routine. I mean, he was only 19 years, but he was with us because he tried to ravish a 7-year-old girl. Our farm bailiff, Henry Long, grew fond of him. We were sorry to see him go.
That'll soon be your last day, the group. I must say, you've been a good worker all these years. If you just dig the old trench up to the wall this morning, that'll do. Got a load of potatoes in. Not that you'll see any of them.
I like potatoes.
Oh, I know you do that. Are you looking forward to seeing your grandma? Mr. Gerland told me she's happy for you to be going home to live with her. Right then. I've enjoyed our conversation. Keep digging.
And Henry Groom did. He certainly did keep digging.
They should hang the wretch attacking an old woman like that.
Did you see her arms? Black and blue they were.
You only just let him out of his sight. Never should have let him go.
It was just his grandma would be up.
Who didn't attack someone else at all?
His aunt.
Two of them, both women.
Punched his grandmother and punched his aunt. Laid into her like she was a man. It was in the paper.
He should get hard labour.
Well, I keep wondering why. I mean, his grandma took him in and his aunt's a quiet woman.
Wicked.
After what he tried to do, I mean.
Never should have let him go.
Do you remember when he came out of prison?
Shocking that he only got a month's hard labour. He should have been hanged.
William Jabez Edwards, 1870. I was a draper and a grocer's clerk and proud to be a primitive Methodist, a believer in the simple truth of the Lord. I was a lay preacher. My church was a field. I preach often. So many people flock to hear me, so many meetings. And I grow wild with lack of sleep. And I start to think that my sister Emma is an idiot. And I strike her with my fist. Many times. I swear that I will take the poker from the fire and bring it down upon her head. Emma is in mortal fear of me. I thrust a knife into her face. I'm a lay preacher. I believe in the simple truth of the Lord. I judge.
Well, when I was courting, Mariana whispered in my ear. Not such a suitable name for a widow aged 64 with 11 living children.
Mariana Spall. Admitted 12th of October, 1885. Roman Catholic. Occupation.
11. I never thought I would have so many living children. I'm like the old woman who lived in a show. She was cruel, mind. I never took a switch to mine. Well, hardly ever. I'd learn them not to be trouble. Never could stand a house full of crying children. My husband died suddenly. He was a good man. Never had a word for himself. He used to say to me, if I was good at one thing, I was good at talking. Well, that and having healthy babies. 11 children, all living. They came into the kitchen the day he died. I remember it clear as if it were yesterday. It was the middle of spring. Warm.
Mariana.
What are you doing here at this hour? I've got a heap of chores and you cluttering up my kitchen.
Mariana.
I've been setting the
scallions this morning. Must send Edward out to put some nets across to make sure them damn pigeons don't pull them out of the ground. John, take that dog out into the garden. What have I told you before? Indy, the sheets are in the scullery. You need to go on the washing line. What are you waiting for?
Ariana.
What is it? Can't you see I'm busy? Why, it's a sheep. Come in then, don't you stand there by the door?
He never got up again.
I couldn't understand why God would take the father of 11 children and leave me a widow. No fire in the smithy, nothing but ash, and no one to work the bellows. So how was I to keep us from the workhouse? I lived in a trance. Morning came as soon as I lay my head down at night. The house was full of cries, shouts and laughter and singing. And kept me going. Gladdened my heart to hear so many voices. Oh, here they come, all my children.
If I had a drink, if I did, what of it? I'd only be telling me my business, telling me what's best for me. I am a widow, and I brought all those children up.
It's the quiet in the house that haunts me. Gets into my bones. I couldn't remember what it was like to be a wife. I remembered when I was a girl, and I fancied that the old apple tree in the garden was calling to me. I danced around my apple tree. I have always known the apple tree. It was strong and would never leave me. I can feel its love for me. Ariana! So, I put on my wedding garments and I put my arms around the tree and I pressed my cheek into its bark and I married my apple tree. My witnesses are the birds in the sky. My promises made to the roots under the earth. I don't understand. What is this place?
Jane?
You're going ahead with it then?
Did you hear that?
What?
Never mind.
your card at Christmas.
Oh, I was a lucky one.
Oh, I'm really looking forward to it, you know. Working with a team on the front line, actually, in the community.
Yeah, I always said you were insane.
You look after yourself and the kids. Keep Janine off the backs.
Well, who's going to keep her online?
There'll be another me along soon enough. No. There won't.
When I was a boy, I watched the winter sea at Sheringham. And I used to imagine walking all the way across it to the Netherlands, as if the old primeval littoral of Doggerland existed still. The thought of it used to fill me with excitement. But that sea, that path was always lost to someone like me. Instead, I looked about me. And what is there on this land but the labourer, the skeleton at the plough, farmers driven to melancholy by death, girls in service, and booze. Thrown away. Women so worn with labour that they yearn to sink below the ground. And as I stood in the fields, I preached to the rural poor. And I asked why. Why? If God loved and valued them, why would not their employers and those with authority set above them not blab their due? And I never met a man who loved and valued the poor like God loved and valued them. Never. Until I met Dr. Hills. And he cared for the most broken, the most burdened, and the sickest. And he cared for me. And he became my friend. But I cannot stay another day. Who knows why I began to hear voices? Who knows? But I begin to hear voices again and I cannot concentrate! Dr. Hills, you have given me the greatest companionship. Cannot watch the tide as you do.
if anyone could have saved me, that would have been you, Dr. Hills.
When I am dead, my dearest, sing no sad songs for me. Lie thou no roses at my head, nor shady cypress tree. Be the green grass above me, with showers and
to see Dr. Hills walking alone.
Yes.
Sorrowing. I think he's going to leave us too.
I shall not see the shadows. I shall not feel the rain. I shall
service as medical superintendent, I now regretfully tender my resignation. Though the severance from the home of so many years, where I've spent some of the happiest times of my life, will be a wrench, yet the constant strain and anxiety of so prolonged a work compel me to relinquish my post.
Dr. Hills, if it was in our power to refuse you, or indeed to order in a dozen more of you, we'd do so. You've created here a true asylum. And we're all in your debt.
Thank you. Grateful for all the support that you have afforded.
I must admit the grand piano did test us, but I understand it's been a welcome addition to our community, and five of the female patients play.
You are always very persuasive, Dr. Hills. Even if I did detect a carrot and stick approach.
We are sorry beyond words at your departure. As is every pauper patient here.
You did create an ideal society.
And your compassion has saved many and will not be forgotten.
Thank you for your kind words, but this asylum will be nothing without the staff. Or indeed the patients who help each other through their suffering. Or you. Gentlemen, without your support, I could have achieved nothing. I hope that what we did here will be a beacon for all those in need, for all those with a duty of care. I am so weary. I know that on every street and in many homes now and in times to come, there are those who suffer not just the maladies of the body, but the distress of the mind. We think we are immune. No one is immune. I say to all my patients, let your story stand as testimony to our compassion. I have done my best. But if I have learned one thing, it is that one man's best is never enough. And we have come a long way from the days when pauper patients slept naked on filthy straw. We no longer conceal, bury or beat. But we must beware that we do not ignore. For what greater isolation is there than a man who is a stranger to his own mind and strange to his own kind? And what are we if we do not reach out to those who suffer? What are we if we do not love those whose minds are simple, broken or tormented? What are we if, lamp in hand, we do not light the darkness? I am leaving now, for I can no longer watch this tide. But others will watch after me. And remember that once there was a time when the sick in mind enjoyed the same dignity as the sick in body.
I shall not see the shadows, I shall not feel the rain, I shall not hear the nightingale sing on as if in pain, and dreaming through the twilight that doth not rise nor set.
Then haply may remember.